a video series on quail management and ties in the latest and largest quail research study in Missouri. This is the third video in a series, so if you haven't watched the first two, you might want to check those out first. In this video, I'll be talking with Missouri Department of Conservation's Kyle Hedges about what prompted the study.
Quail have been declining for many years, decades now, and historically, Missouri Department of Conservation and a lot of other agencies as well managed quail similar to, it was based off of old dairy farm setup where we would have a food strip, a grass strip, a shrub strip. Everything was broken into blocks. Very broken up habitat. We call it strip cropping. We're doing all this work and we're observing on the public land that we were actually having superior quail numbers on some of our grassland units where we weren't even trying to manage for quail, as opposed to these what were called quail emphasis areas. So we started scratching our head and saying, man, are we missing something here? We need to try to figure this out. So we were lucky enough to get some funding and did a 5-year quail research project. Turned out to be the largest quail research project ever conducted in the state of Missouri. Over 1,500 quail radio collared in that period, over 500 nests monitored. So it's a giant data set, and it really told us a lot about how quail are using the landscape and where they're being most successful.
Yeah. So, well, what kind of management techniques did you all use to get quail on your property?
On the grassland sites that we were comparing, that we were noticing superior populations, sometimes threefold superior to these traditionally managed sites. The principal management tools are fire and grazing. That's all we were using. These were natural disturbances. We don't disc, we don't use strip disking or strip spraying, any techniques like that, because these were remnant prairies. However, they don't have to be. I mean, we've seen some of these same results on replantings.
So, Kyle, what's caused this quail decline in Missouri?
Yeah, so specifically in Missouri, it's different all across the nation, but specifically in Missouri, it's a long list of things that have gone wrong. Everything stacked against the poor little quail. But let me give you a little history real quick. So back up. You know, historically, landscape was way more open. The western half of Missouri was way more open, and then the Ozarks even would have been more of an open woodland, savanna type habitat. So if you go out into the prairie landscape, back in the 1800s, we would have had reduced quail populations because woody thermal cover, shrubby thickets, would have been one of the limiting factors. So a lot of the landscape maybe wasn't necessarily preferred by quail. We had prairie chickens all over the landscape. We elevated into, as the land got broken up, and this is why Missouri Department of Conservation set areas up traditionally managed, when the land got broken up, it actually benefited quail. Because for short term, we had all these different plant species. We had grain crops to feed the dairy cows over here, and we had different forages going all the time, and everybody had a couple goats and a couple sheep, and this landscape was really chopped up. Well, quail liked the edge, so it worked out great for them for a while. Those hedgerows that got planted were good. They were scrubby and shrubby. But then eventually they grew up in the big tall hedge trees. Those aren't good for quail anymore. Now they're raptor perches, of course. Then came fescue introduction. And fescue has had a role, certainly, and a purpose in Missouri. But for quail, it doesn't grow the right form at ground level. It's a sod forming grass, and it makes it where little chicks can't get their feet to the ground. They get wet. It gets either too thick or it's overgrazed. So you have two options typically with fescue. They can't walk through it, or there's no overhead cover. The species diversity within fescue pastures is typically limited. So now we've lost our broadleaf plants and a lot of other things that quail need to attract those insects for brooding. Add to it, and I'm not picking on any chemical company, but Roundup Ready crops. You know, back in the 1940s and 50s, we didn't have broad spectrum herbicides. So crop fields were weedier, and quail and pheasants and things like that could utilize those areas. That's gone now. We have the farming technology has improved. So we can cut wheat stubble even lower, so there's less residual for birds to utilize. So all of these things have stacked up against the poor little quail. It's been a natural occurrence of things, and we, as a human race, of course, we're going to continue to strive to make higher yielding crops, and all that stuff's important. There's going to be more and more people to feed in the future, but we've got to figure out how environmentally we also can protect not only quail, but pollinators and all these other species that utilize the landscape. Where we've gone back in, so where we've tried to plant traditional areas and we planted grass strips. Well, that was a great idea. We're trying to mimic the dairy farms, except we didn't have livestock as a part of it. We missed one big component. And then we planted cultivar grasses. Typically they get bigger and more robust. Well, if you're not grazing those, then they get really thick. So all of a sudden we don't have maneuverability for quail. So there's all these things that even when we tried to do the right thing on some public lands or some private outreach efforts, some of them didn't work out right. We just didn't understand all of the science. We didn't understand what these birds needed. And that's what this quail research project has really shown us, is some more fine scale detail of what these birds need and what they're utilizing, what they're not utilizing. Some of that data, you know, when you put a little radio collar on a bird and it doesn't, all these birds don't use a portion of your area, tells you just as much as what they are using. So me as a manager, I'm able to say, wow, we got a problem over here and I need to figure out how to fix that.
So what were some of the main results from this research that you all did?
Well, so we discovered that, in fact, nesting was superior on grasslands as opposed to traditional management, nesting success. Brood rearing success was also superior, and adult survival. So all three factors that drive population numbers were superior on grasslands. We had 13% higher nest success. And this is multiple repetitions. We had three grassland sites. We had three traditional sites at the end. A couple of sites got added a year into it. 13% higher nest success on these grassland sites. We had 6% higher adult survival. So right off the bat, if you think about, that's during the breeding season, adult survival. We also had superior adult survival during the winter time too. But if you think about during the breeding season, if even just 6% doesn't sound like a lot, but if 6% of the quail more are making it through the breeding season, then they're available to breed or re-nest if they lose their first nest. So it just compounds the number of nests.
Yeah.
That was another factor we saw. Higher nest effort on the grassland sites. We saw pairing and nest initiation up to 2 weeks earlier on the grassland sites. And there's some factors we think are involved with that. Probably it's a nutritional plane. Because of the diversity of the plants and the seed and bug availability, coming out of late winter, early spring, where food is a very limited resource, we believe these birds on the grasslands had a superior nutritional plane and were able to start nesting sooner. There's plenty of documentation all over the country for any ground nesting birds, turkeys, quail, lots of other species, that the earlier you nest, the more successful you are, right? There's less predators on the landscape. The baby raccoons aren't out on the landscape yet. They're still in the den. The baby possums are still riding on mom's back. The snakes, the cooler it is, the snakes are cooler, so they're not feeding as heavy. So all of this favors if you can nest sooner. So 2 week earlier nest initiation was critical. We even had higher clutch sizes on the grasslands. We had about an egg and a half more per nest on the grasslands compared to traditional sites. So everything points to this superior productivity on these grassland sites.
Possibly diverse natives for grazing could be a solution too. A lot of problems to quail habitat that we need here in the state.
Oh, absolutely. Diverse natives is a critical component of it. It's not just about the species, it's about the structure too. We need different heights of vegetation. We need different leaf configurations of vegetation. All these things play into how the quail survive. I mean, it's a every day is an effort and a miracle if a quail makes it to the next day. You know, their average lifespan is 8 months. Most of them never get to see their first birthday. Everything likes to eat quail. They're delicious. So they really have to have all the right conditions to thrive.
It's been so great talking with Kyle and seeing how wildlife and grazing aren't at odds. As a seed producer and rancher, I've seen how diversity makes life easier for me by filling the solar collector with growing plants. Cool season grass, warm season grass, wildflowers, and legumes, all growing together, can economically feed cattle season long. Diverse natives improve soil health, bring in a wide variety of insects and pollinators, and it's best for quail and other wildlife. Over the years, I've seen that fire is the least expensive tool for managing my fields. It's been interesting hearing how grazing and burning is also the best thing for quail. But it makes sense because that's what our landscape had historically. Thanks, Kyle, for coming out to the farm and sharing with us about how easy quail management can be.